We will now begin recording the interview with Mary Newman. The recording takes place on the 2nd of March 2017 at Radio Cardiff. The volunteers present are Kaylee Williams and Lara Taffer, and this recording is being collected as an oral history and will be part of the Chronicle Project, a project led by VCS Cymru and funded by the Heritage Lottery Fund. So Mary, would you introduce yourself for me, please?
Yes. I'm Mary Newman. I'm 51 years of age. I was born in Cardiff and has lived in Cardiff all my life. I am married for almost 59 years. I have 7 children, 10 grandchildren and 2 great-grandchildren. I'm doing this interview mainly to encourage people to volunteer, and by doing that I'll go into my history with VCS. Yeah, I first became aware of VCS in 1975. Llaneddyn, where I still live, was a new estate, and VCS had leafleted the area to ask if people were interested in a summer adventure play scheme. I think about 5 people turned up to that meeting, but we ended up having the summer play schemes for 2 years. In the interim, we found out that there was a site allocated for an adventure playground on the master plan for Llaneddyn. We got in touch with the city council. They said we could have the land, and we had that land. The adventure playground took place in the woods initially. Then some parents got together and formed an association. And we then needed from VCS advice on how to set up a constitution. That was done. There was an issue at the time that went on for years over whether a parent could be on the committee to interview members of staff. The people who got involved in those days, because most women stayed at home to look after the children, meant that within the community, women with their families got involved with whatever was going on, and there was so much that developed and through the community mainly in that particular area. From the adventure playgrounds developed the Cardiff Playground Association that used to meet in VCS in town. That became almost, because that was mostly women, that was our social life. From that again developed other volunteering opportunities. The director of VCS at the time thought that I should go to college before I was too old to go to college. But in the interim, there was a vacancy for a job as a community development worker in Grangetown. Because they needed somebody fast who knew Grangetown to go into there, that was offered to me, and I took it, and I did that for 2 years. I was still pushed to go to college. I would have liked to have done a course on youth and community, but that would have meant either going to Swansea or North Wales, which is an impossibility with the family. So I studied as a social worker and gained the social work qualification. All that while I was still involved in some way or other with VCS. An interesting period there was when there was a move to move VCS from a directorship into management, and we had what we called the revolution, which was really interesting. Everybody was knocked off the committee except Robert Davis, who had established VCS in the city. I think it was about 9 months later when I had a call to say, will you come back on the committee? I was on the committee for a while then. What VCS did for me was completely change my life because of one piece of paper, really, that went through the letterbox. I also became involved because of volunteering and campaigning in my area, got involved in politics, and then I became a councillor for 11 years. So there was my job, college, getting on to council. And there was a gap in my involvement with VCS. And I'm not sure, looking back, on why. But then I think maybe 15, 16 years ago that I received a call asking me would I get involved again. And it was within a year, unfortunately, the chair of VCS at that time passed away. And then I became chairman of VCS. I've been so since. How much longer they'll keep me, I don't know. but I would always say to people, if you're looking for something to do, volunteer. Volunteering really isn't about you doing something for somebody else. I'm sure there are many more stories like mine about how people's lives have changed and how much more you get back from volunteering as well. And sadly, in today's environment, VCS is struggling, but we'll stay there. We'll survive somehow or other. Because funding's difficult today. Not just for VCS, the voluntary sector is really suffering. Don't worry about in your own communities. If there are things you need, still try and fight. Originally in Llaneddon, you know, we'd meet in somebody's front room. It was your house, you can be the chair. Or Mary's scribbling, she can be the secretary. And how things move on from that. And you can do things for yourself. But there's been a change, I think, in a way, sadly. My generation, the women stayed at home mostly to bring up the children. So people had time and wanted to get involved in things, particularly on new estates when there's nothing else there. And you can achieve it. I was involved with the committee that I think it was 3 million at the time to convert an old, broken down, getting smashed to bits, old boiler house that was converted into the powerhouse, which became a flagship for using buildings in the community when they were being left to rot, taking them on and sorting them out. It was an excellent project, it really was, and sadly in some ways the local authority have now taken it on and it's being converted into a hub. Because the community don't seem to be going in there so much at the moment. It's like a hiatus within the community, but we need to wait and see what happens. The building's being extended. When it's open to the public, then hopefully it will survive the way the powerhouse did for over 20 years. There are so many avenues to volunteer to get things out of it. To encourage people, because I don't know if people realise we could bring the country to a standstill. If people stop volunteering, then the local authorities, government, nobody could fund them when you look at the organisations volunteering. Like St John's Ambulance, I think it's scouting. People don't seem to think of scouting, being involved with scouts as being volunteering. It is. It's been my husband's sort of lifelong. That was the thing that he was really involved in. And even now, he helps to maintain buildings. He's there today, it's a Thursday, every Thursday. He goes to Miskin. It's the main scout camping area. They maintain the buildings and the lands around. yeah, go for it. And I think if you ask retired people, what are they, you know, how are they filling your time? Don't you miss going to work? I would reckon that most of them will say you're busier when you leave work by getting involved in things. That, yeah, don't be afraid of retirement. It doesn't have to kill you. And even more so today, people are going to have to get up again and do things for themselves. Because sadly, I think there's a belief sometimes amongst politicians is that the community can't do it for itself. And it can. And it can achieve things. Hard luck if 20 years on they suddenly disappear, but it won't be long before people will, you know, come together and strive to bring things back. I mean, one of the saddest things now is the money being taken out of youth. I can only reflect on my own area where all the beautiful fields around a primary school and a secondary modern school were available to the public. Sadly, again, reflecting today's society, all those fields are fenced off. There's hardly anywhere now for people to play. Funding has been taken out from the youth sector. Hopefully, outreach work can be done with the youth so that they're not, you know, just hanging about with nothing to do. Yeah, it's about taking it in your own hands and doing something about it. And God knows how much longer I've got in this world, but I'll hopefully keep going and encourage other people to do the same thing, get out there and do it, and get, you know, people around you to join in, get involved. And I think, even in my own area, I think the fact that I went to college, other people thought, if she can do it, I can do it. Yeah, you can make an amazing difference to people and what goes on in your community. And it's not just down to one individual. I'm the one being interviewed, but it's not just about me. It's about everybody else in my own community that got together to do things for it and be successful at doing it, and to say, you know, you can do it in your community as well.
Okay, so I mean, you've touched upon this already slightly, but when you got involved back in the 1970s, how did that Adventure Playground scheme impact your community?
It was somewhere for the children to go. And I mean, initially, we didn't have a building. So when we managed to employ somebody to be responsible for the playground, everything just took place in the woods around. We had an aerial runway. For our sins, we had tunnels. you know, just and the kids played in the woods and they built things. In some ways, the death knell of adventure, that was the word, adventure play, was killed by the introduction of health and safety when they used building regulations, and you couldn't do this and you couldn't do that. And the most surprising thing was the aerial runway passed muster. But, you know, the children were free to play in a way they don't seem to play anymore. They were able at the beginning to, you know, use hammers and nails, build these grotty looking structures, you know, step on rusty nails, but it would say, oh, down the infirmary, get a tetanus injection, and then the kids, they'd be back on the playground. Yeah, it developed really well, and what was interesting, there was a point where Cardiff City Council, they said they had a building, and but they couldn't put the foundations in, so that was quite a laugh. But, you know, through one another, got the men together to put the shuttering in for the base, and somebody turned up with a lorry load of concrete, so the base was put, you know, the base was put in. That was, you know, that was purely the community. That building is still standing, which is nice to know. And it has been taken over now because Adventure Players, the funding for Adventure Players finished, and has been taken over by a local scout group that was having to travel for its meetings, and they will be offering the building for some community activities in the day, and scouting activities take place at night. And they, yeah, that started it all.
And so now that you're chair of VCS,
yeah,
how has your role with the organisation changed since you were volunteering? You know, what are you involved with, the coordinating of volunteers, or?
So what's your role now as chair?
No, my role is that it's a chair. Since I'm originally, I was a member of, just a member of the committee. And then, I shouldn't say just, I was a member of the committee. And as time developed, as time moved on rather, you get used to the different roles within a committee. And there were other committees I was involved in, leading from being involved with VCS. On a number of occasions, I've received phone calls and it said, Mary, we haven't got a chair, we're going to be doing, I think there was a time, resource centre or something to do with it, didn't have a chair. Will you come back? It won't be for long. Well, that turned into a couple of years, didn't it? Looking at VCS, what is amazing is the amount of things that it innovated in this city. I mean, the first adventure playground, but it's run by VCS. It identified the other sites, but it couldn't run them all themselves. So that's why they ended up in the hands of the local authority and survived for a lot longer than I thought, thanks to them. There were subcommittees to VCS that I was on Interval when that was set up. Then on from Interval, was it VAC? Voluntary Action Cardiff.
Yeah, that, there was VCA and VAC.
They're different.
Voluntary Action Cardiff.
No, it was Voluntary Action Cardiff, yeah. I was involved with that. And that'll lead me on to something else. We learned to take on the roles within the community activities, the roles of chair and secretary and usually treasurer. Yeah. You didn't need to be told to go on a training course to know how to do these things, because back then they weren't doing training courses. You know, that, I mean, that's one of the things VCS did introduce. VCS, they were doing training sessions for a lot more things than training for the roles, but their training was informal. A lot of people, including me, didn't like getting involved in training that meant I was going to be criticised and checked on and all the rest. That was a school, comes from your image of school days. Yeah, I don't know how to put that in a better way. Yeah, it goes back to that. And yeah, we're all capable of doing things. We don't always need long training courses. Some of these things come instinctively because of need within or wherever you are, or the need to get involved in something. And what VCS has offered in the past was the front desk, where somebody could go in, speak to whoever was on the front desk, decide that they might want to work with children, then talking through all the activity, all the places that VCS were involved in, find that their forte was in something completely different. That's the sadness now about the, you know, we've lost the volunteer bureau. But there are so many things it did in, there was the flat shop, there was job shop, single women's housing group. There are an awful lot of things in this city come from individuals volunteering, individuals wanting to get on and do things and reaping benefits themselves.
I know that funding was taken away from VCS, but why was the funding taken away, and why doesn't the Volunteer Bureau still reside with VCS? What happened politically there? Was there...
The cutbacks in funding to numerous things these days. Obviously the country, you know, has to look at what money it has or doesn't have. It depends on the way they deal with that. I think the unfortunate thing about funding cuts is it hits the community first. You know, nothing to do with us. You can take it out if you like. My heart bleeds for the Rhondda. The deprivation there, and you know, they are losing a lot more than we do. I mean, at the moment, well, we've lost the library in Llanedon, but in the old powerhouse there's a huge hall, so the library's gone into there, and I haven't been there to have a look to see, you know, what's happening, how that's working there. The police station, they'll shut the, well, yeah, the police will move into the hub when it's finished as well. I believe there's a community cafe at the moment, and that will be run by a charity, and again it's the charities that function because of the number of people who volunteer. VCS lost its core funding, which meant that we would possibly have to close on, you know, or not. We had some reserves, and the committee in its wisdom decided to use those reserves to keep us going for another year. Now, because we've become involved with Cardiff Radio, hopefully that will raise funding that VCS continues, and then get back to where it was. It survived a number of sort of crunches that have happened, cutbacks in funding, having to cut back on what they were doing. And if we get the funding again, we can go back into doing the things that we did years ago. I can remember a gardening project and a grotty old van that, you know, volunteers would go out and do people's gardens. Because you often have people, particularly on the big estates, you know, people had gotten older, they couldn't do their gardens. So, you know, we'd go along doing their front gardens. Sometimes I think they'd have decorating project. I think I could go on forever if we really researched what were the things that VCS had actually innovated.
Did you have a favourite project that you worked on?
I think for me it was the playground originally. And that was influenced, I suppose, by, you know, the children around and how women, and interestingly enough, it was those with the bigger families who you know, got really involved. One of my fondest memories of the playground was doing a disco in an underpass, because we didn't have the building at the time, on the electric cable running to the nearest house to plug in there. And I think I had a baby in a pram stuck under the underpass, listening to music, the kids dancing. On there we had some great times. We ran a few bonfire nights where the word extremely successful, because what the council did was take down the bonfires from the open land everywhere else, and we ran bonfire night and, you know, had pits and did big potatoes and all the rest of it. And the first one we did, I think there were at least 1,000 people there. We did a collection, we only collected £32, and even back in those days, I think the, you know, the display fireworks were quite expensive. But we managed that, and yeah, and our little committee. I was chair of that for a while, and treasurer for years, for the association. And that's how you help again then. The association could be used to raise funds, whereas an employee of the city council couldn't raise funds themselves. Probably still got all the treasurer's books as well. It was that. I always felt that that's where my volunteering started. But my sister, after my mum died, found some papers in the house where I'd been the secretary of a committee on a youth club, in the youth club. We weren't all that old, but I thought, oh, I was treasurer. I'm being critical then. I don't know. There were gaps, definitely. Obviously, in 1959, I went to Cyprus for 2 years. I had two of the children there. Came back, and to me, my life was going to be about bringing up the children, and influenced by being on a new estate, because there is absolutely nothing there. People were moving into houses and they didn't even have pavements to get to them, you know, mud was still around the place. It really was an interesting time. It was like my getting involved with politics. I was secretary of a committee was set up to have temporary classrooms at the local school. Now, another school had got temporary classrooms. No fuss, no bother. Not Blaneddon, no. We were going to have to fight. And we set up a committee. And I was secretary of that. And I can remember one day, because we were linked with, because the school took in part of Kincoyd, so some of the Kincoyd parents were there, and they asked one night, where were the people from the council estate? So somebody using an expletive said, where the, do you think Mary Newman comes from? And one night we had the councillors there. When I look back, I called them faceless wonders. There was an election coming up. It'll happen now because there's an election coming up soon. And from that, I got involved politically, and then was asked to stand for council. It's been an interesting life. And really, I mean, nobody knows what would have happened if those leaflets hadn't come through the door. But they, from then on, that influenced my life. Possibly, I'm trying to think of how did I first come to work with homeless. I did a placement at Cardiff Cyrenians that was on Tresillian Terrace. I don't know if you know where the hoardings are at the moment. There's four little houses. Cyrenians, they were in that empty space there. I did the placement at Cyrenians. Prior to that, because VCS was involved, I think, with the setting up of Cyrenians in Cardiff in the first place, and now and again homeless people would come into VCS, they'd come up the stairs, you know, and so I'd known about homelessness anyway. And that, again, really was through VCS. Being interviewed That was interesting, the size of the interview panel. And things going round me. I'm not sure if John Drysdale was on that interviewing panel, but John Drysdale, Winston Drysdale was here for that radio interview on Tuesday. Yeah, and I hadn't seen him for a long time.
Has there been, over the years, people that you volunteer with, do they become part of your social life as well as?
Well, when I look back, the Cardiff Adventure Play Association, it was mostly Lanedon, Ely. I'm not sure, did anyone used to come from Grangetown? Splott and Adamstown, Land Rumney, there were one or two that didn't bother much. But to me, going out of an evening to go to VCS for a meeting was like social life. That was the only time back then that I went out at night. Yeah, that's a reflection, really. And I was surprised the other day, particularly the two ladies from Ely, you know, remembering them and remembering their names. Could you get to my age and names start to disappear? Yeah. Joan Hughes and Shirley Collins. Oh, dear.
Are you still in contact with any of the people that were on the Adventure Playground boards or anybody else that had been involved?
No, not really. Not involved. I mean, somebody might speak to me on the bus and say something. It was like somebody recently said, asked me if I was Mary Newman. I said, I think so. I shouldn't have really, because the lady then said to me, oh, I'm so grateful. She said, when you were a counsellor, you were able to help. And I said, that was my job at the time. And, you know, great that you, that your problem was resolved.
How do you feel when you get recognised for your voluntary work and your work as a counsellor?
I wouldn't so much now. It was nice recently when somebody stopped me on the estate and I didn't even recognise the lady. And she said, thank you for all the things you did for Laned. And I was quite taken aback at that because, yeah, I don't really like being public.
But so if it's not for the recognition, what motivates you to volunteer? And what motivated you to be involved with
DCS? Well, the value of it, and you know, if somebody needed help to get themselves going, well, if I had the time, when I've got the time, then I'll do that. And as I say, try and encourage people to volunteer. And this is why VCS to me has to survive. When you take the two, how many projects at the moment pave the way? Laura's job, Laura, what's the title of her job? I can't remember. But it's working with offenders, and I'm really interested in working with ex servicemen. I think a lot of that for me is growing up during the war. I mean, people go, you weren't alive in the war, were you? Yeah, which one, the first or second? Oh, dear God. And I think it's sad today on Facebook when you look at how many ex-servicemen are homeless and a lack of understanding of how and why they become homeless. If you think about the structured life they've led, you know, especially the ones who do their fight 25 years, and the discipline, and they just don't cope with coming out. There's so much they have to think about that I honestly don't think they're prepared for it. And if, you know, through Laura's project.
The release project.
Hmm?
Release.
Release project.
Yeah. I was just
reminding. You know, that project only helps one person, you know, to be kept away from the streets. But I think the military, this is totally off the track, isn't it? But there's more recognition outside. I don't believe in there, in the forces. I've heard they're not, pardon me, but for a long time there hasn't been enough done to prepare people to leave, you know, to cope with the fact that they might get a pension, but there's not going to be a salary every month. Maybe not thinking early enough about what's going to happen when they go out. So hopefully Release Project will continue and pave the way. People might find it easier to be involved through the voluntary organisations rather than going through local authority channels to try and resolve the problems. And I mean, you can only advise and help as much as you can. And you will change people's lives if they're, you know, willing and able to do it. But there's so many life changes. When talking about schools, getting into arguments about grammar schools, in a city like Cardiff, they couldn't be elitist. Most of Cardiff was poor back when they were, you know, when I went to school. Most of us were from Grangetown, Splott, Ely, Bewtown, wherever. I don't think it's elitist. But on the other hand, going back in my day, we would be able to get jobs. But all our mates from school, you know, from primary school, there was work for everybody. And if one job finished, they could find a job somewhere else. And they went from school to work. You didn't have this adolescent period, or these poor young things and they're 25. No, they want work, they need work. Oh, don't start me off. Oh, God.
Okay, so, I mean, you've touched upon this already, but if you wanted to inspire somebody to volunteer in 2 to 3 sentences, what would you tell them?
Do it. Go for it. And see what happens. See what it gives you. See what you can get from it. I must admit, I think I was lucky that VCS distributed those leaflets at a time when the director at the time, that's what the revolution was about, they didn't want a director. He must have seen something in me that I didn't see for myself. You know, if I'm writing something, it might be virtually in shorthand, and he'd say, "You've done more than that. Now pad it out." And I think, oh, I don't want to, but yeah, I'll take shortcut sentences if it's talking about me normally.
Can you finish the sentence for me?
No.
Volunteering is ...
Does it have to be is? Volunteering can be a life-changing experience. If you have the opportunity to volunteer, if you're enjoying where you are as a volunteer, make the most of it and take that experience back into your own community. Encourage people to get up and do things. Yeah.
I haven't got any more questions. Have you got anything else you wanted to ask?
Do you want to talk about anything else? Anything you want to add?
No. How on earth are you going to do anything with that when we're laughing half the time?
I can edit it out.
Oh, it could probably seem terribly boring then.
No, it's great.
So thank you very much for taking the time to speak to us today.
Great.
It's almost incredible, isn't it, to think a piece of paper changes your life.